We have plenty of palms this year, so if you want to take some for other people, and people normally do, we'd be able to spare them. Do you think you could gather at the back, please? And just leave a space for me, just in the middle. Hosanna to the Son of David. My dear brothers and sisters, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal Mystery. Today we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal Mystery. that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that, being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. So would you hold up your palms, please? Almighty, ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and dwells forever and ever. Amen. And now we have a reading, the Holy Gospel according to Mark. When they drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples and said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord has need of it, and will send it back here immediately.' And they went away and found a colt tied at the door out in the open street, and they untied it. And those who stood there said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' And they told them what Jesus had said, and they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their garments on it, and he sat upon it. And many spread their garments on the road, and others spread leafy branches which they had cut from the fields. And those who followed cried out, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that is coming. Hosanna in the highest.'" And so, my dear friends, let us go forth on our procession like the crowds who acclaimed Jesus in Jerusalem. Let us go forth in peace. Just follow. Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing, 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 Hosanna to the King. Hosanna to the King of Kings. Hosanna to the King. In my heart I pray, give me love in my heart. I'm Hosanna to the sing, 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 Hosanna to the King, oh King, sing. Sing, Hosanna to the King, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King. Hosanna to the King, oh King, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King. Hosanna to the King of Kings, sing, 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 Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing, King of Kings. The King. I'd like to remember at Mass today very specially Michael Armstrong. And Francis has just reminded me that it's Father Austin's anniversary today. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who, as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit to share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Just to remind you of what I said before about the Passion, and if you kindly sit down for the reading of the Passion, but where on your leaflet it says, see, that's for the congregation to come in. Terry, who'll be here, will be leading that. She'll also have some separate parts herself where it says, oh, but where it says, see, come out with a big, loud proclamation. Oh, children, boys and girls, we'd like to come out, please. Sorry. Yeah. So the Lord be in your heart and on your lips, that you may open the minds of God's children to the truth, and the heart to his love, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
When the saints go marching in, I want to be in that number. When the saints go marching in,
a reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has given me a disciple's tongue, so that I may know how to reply to the weary. He provides me with speech. Each morning he wakes me to hear, to listen like a disciple. The Lord has opened my ear for my part. I made no resistance. Neither did I turn away. I offered my back to those who struck me, my cheeks to those who tore at my beard. I did not cover my face against insult and spittle. The Lord comes to my help, so that I am untouched by the insult. So too I set my face like flint. I know I shall not be shamed. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The responsorial psalm. My God, why have you forsaken me?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
All who see me derate me. They curl their lips, they test their heads. He trusted in the Lord. Let him save him. Let him release him if this is his friend.
My God, why have you forsaken me?
Many dogs have surrounded me. A band of the wicked beset me. They tear holes in my hands and my feet. I can count every one of my bones.
My God, why have you forsaken me?
They divide my clothing among them. They cast lots on my robe. O Lord, do not leave me alone. My strength, make haste to help me.
My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?
I will tell of your name to my brethren and praise you where they are assembled. You who fear the Lord, give him praise. All sons of Jacob, give him glory. Revere him, Israel's sons.
My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. His state was divine, yet Christ Jesus did not cling to his equality with God, but emptied himself to assume the condition of a slave, and became as men are, and being as all men are, he was humbler yet, even to accepting death on a cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all other names, so that all beings in the heavens, on earth, and in the underworld should bend the knee at the name of Jesus, and that every tongue should acclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise to you, O Christ,
King of eternal glory. Christ was humbly yet, even to accepting death on a cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all names. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. Let's just sit down, please. Margaret.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Mark. Sorry.
According to Mark. It was 2 days before the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and the chief priests and scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by some trick and have him put to death. For they said,
"It must not be during the festivities, or there will be a disturbance among the people."
Jesus was at Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper. He was at dinner when a woman came in with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment, pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the ointment on his head. Some who were there said to one another indignantly,
"Why this waste of ointment? Ointment like this could have been sold for over 300 denarii and the money given to the poor."
And they were angry with her. But Jesus said,
"Leave her alone. Why are you upsetting her? What she has done for me is one of the good works. You have the poor with you always, and you can be kind to them whenever you wish, but you will not always have me. She has done what was in her power to do. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. I tell you solemnly, wherever throughout all the world the good news is proclaimed, what she has done will be told also in remembrance of her."
Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, approached the chief priests with an offer to hand Jesus over to them. They were delighted to hear it and promised to give him money. And he looked for a way of betraying him when the opportunity should occur. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb was sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
"Go into the city, and you will meet a man carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him, and say to the owner of the house which he enters, 'The master says, where is my dining room in which I can eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large upper room furnished with couches, all prepared. Make the preparations for us there.'"
The disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them and prepared the Passover. When evening came, he arrived with the 12. And while they were at table eating, Jesus said,
"I tell you solemnly, one of you is about to betray me, one of you eating with me."
They were distressed and asked him one after another,
"Not I, surely."
He said to them,
"It is one of the 12, one who is dipping into the same dish with me. Yet the Son of Man is going to his fate, as the scriptures say he will. But alas for that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Better for that man if he had never been born."
And as they were eating, he took some bread, and when he had said the blessing, he broke it and gave it to them, saying,
"Take it, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, and when he had returned thanks, he gave it to them, and all drank from it. And he said to them,
"This is my blood, the blood of the covenant, which is to be poured out for many. I tell you solemnly, I shall not drink any more wine until the day I drink the new wine in the kingdom of God."
After psalms had been sung, they left for the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
"You will all lose faith, for the scripture says, 'I shall strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' However, after my resurrection, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said,
"Even if all lose faith, I will not."
And Jesus said to him,
"I tell you solemnly, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will have disowned me 3 times.
But he repeated still more earnestly,
"If I have to die with you, I will never disown you."
And they all said the same. They came to a small estate called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples,
"Stay here while I pray."
Then he took Peter and James and John with him, and a sudden fear came over him and great distress. And he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful to the point of death. Wait here and keep awake."
And going on a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, this hour might pass him by. He said,
"Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup away from me, but let it be as you, not I, would have it."
He came back and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Had you not the strength to keep awake 1 hour? You should be awake and praying, not to be put to the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came back and found them sleeping. Their eyes were so heavy, and they could find no answer for him. He came back a third time and said to them,
"You can sleep on now and take a rest. It is all over. The hour has come. Now the Son of Man is to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us go. My betrayer is close at hand already."
Even while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, came up with a number of men armed with swords and clubs, sent by the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. Now the traitor had arranged a signal with them. He had said,
"The one I kiss, he is the man. Take him in charge and see he is well guarded when you lead him away."
So when the traitor came, he went straight up to Jesus and said,
"Rabbi,"
and kissed him. The others seized him and took him in charge. Then one of the bystanders drew his sword and struck out at the high priest's servant and cut off his ear. Then Jesus spoke,
"Am I a brigand that you had to set out to capture me with swords and clubs? I was among you teaching in the temple day after day, and you never laid hands on me. But this was to fulfill the scriptures."
And they all deserted him and ran away. A young man who followed him had nothing on but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the cloth in their hands and ran away naked. They led Jesus off to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes assembled there. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the high priest's palace, and was sitting at a distance, and was sitting with the attendants, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus on which they might pass the death sentence, but they could not find any. Several indeed brought false evidence against him, but their evidence was conflicting. Some stood up and submitted this false evidence against him:
"We heard him say, 'I am going to destroy this temple made by human hands, and in 3 days build another not made by human hands.'"
But even on this point, their evidence was conflicting. The high priest then stood up before the whole assembly and put this question to Jesus:
"Have you no answer to that? What is this evidence these men are bringing against you?"
But he was silent and made no answer at all. The high priest put a second question to him:
"Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Jesus said,
"I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
The high priest tore his robes and said,
"What need of witnesses have we now? You heard the blasphemy. What is your finding?"
And they all gave their verdict: he deserved to die. Some of them started spitting at him and, blindfolding him, began hitting him with their fists and shouting,
"Slay the prophet!"
And the attendants rained blows on him. While Peter was down below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's servant girls came up. She saw Peter warming himself there, stared at him and said,
"You too were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth."
But he denied it, saying,
"I do not know. I do not understand what you are talking about."
And he went out into the forecourt. The servant girl saw him and again started telling the bystanders,
This fellow is one of them.
But again he denied it. A little later, the bystanders themselves said to Peter,
"You are one of them for sure. Why, you are a Galilean."
But he started calling curses on himself and swearing,
"I do not know the man you speak of."
At that moment, the cock crew for the second time. And Peter recalled how Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will have disowned me three times." And he burst into tears. First thing in the morning, the chief priests, together with the elders and scribes, in short, the whole Sanhedrin, had their plan ready. They had Jesus bound and took him away and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He answered,
"It is you who say it."
And the chief priests brought many accusations against him. Pilate questioned him again,
"Have you no reply at all? See how many accusations they are bringing against you."
But to Pilate's amazement, Jesus made no further reply. At festival time, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone they asked for. Now, a man called Barabbas was then in prison with the rioters who had committed murder during the uprising. When the crowd went up and began to ask Pilate the customary favor, Pilate answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed Jesus over. The chief priests, however, had incited the crowd to demand that he should release Barabbas for them instead. Then Pilate spoke again.
"But in that case, what am I to do with the man you call King of the Jews?"
Pilate asked them,
"Why? What harm has he done?"
But they shouted all the louder,
"Crucify him!"
So Pilate, anxious to placate the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and having ordered Jesus to be scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away to the inner part of the palace, that is the praetorium, and called the whole cohort together. They dressed him up in purple, twisted some thorns into a crown and put it on him, and they began saluting him.
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
They struck his head with a reed and spat on him, and they went down on their knees to do him homage. And when they had finished making fun of him, they took off the purple and dressed him in his own clothes. They led him out to crucify him. They enlisted a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, father of Alexander and Rufus, who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. They offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he refused it. Then they crucified him and shared out his clothing, casting lots to decide what each one should get. It was the third hour when they crucified him. The inscription giving the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And they crucified two robbers with him, one on his right and one on his left. The passers-by jeered at him. They shook their heads and said,
"Aha! So you would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Then save yourself. Come down from the cross."
The chief priests and the scribes mocked him among themselves in the same way. They said,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, for us to see it and believe.
Even those who were crucified with him taunted him. When the sixth hour came, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani?"
This means, my God, why have you deserted me?" When some of those who stood by heard this, they said,
"Listen, he is calling on Elijah."
Someone ran and soaked a sponge in vinegar, and putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait and see if Elijah will come down to take him down."
But Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The centurion who was standing in front of him had seen how he had died, and he said,
"In truth, this man was a son of God."
There were some women watching from a distance. Among them were Mary of Magdala, Mary who was the mother of James the younger, and Joseph and Salome. These used to follow him and look after him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women there who had come up to Jerusalem with him. It was now evening, and since it was preparation day, that is the vigil of the Sabbath, there came Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council, who himself lived in the hope of seeing the kingdom of God. And he boldly went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate, astonished that he should have died so soon, summoned the centurion and inquired if he was already dead. Having been assured of this by the centurion, he granted the corpse to Joseph, who brought a shroud, took Jesus down from the cross, wrapped him in the shroud, and laid him in a tomb which had been hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a stone against the entrance to the tomb. Mary of Magdala and Mary, the mother of Joseph, were watching and took note of where he was laid.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Ever since I was a little lad, Good Friday afternoon, that 3 o'clock service has always been the most solemn moment I could ever imagine, as it is with you too, I know. But the death of Jesus, of just who Jesus was, and his ultimate significance for all of us, we can only consider it with amazement and with gratitude and with profound adoration of God. That in his death, Jesus confronted evil in every form, evil which tried to suppress him, to destroy him. And it failed. On the front of the newsletter, there's a quotation from a man called Cahil Gibran. He was a Lebanese Christian who wrote many things, and normally on a Good Friday I would hand out a sheet which has got this larger passage that he's written. But just here, I've just included this short passage. But Jesus was never humiliated. He never lived a life of fear. There were no complaints as he died. He lived as a leader. He died with a heroism which frightened his tormentors. He defied despots. He confronted oppression. He crushed evil. He came to make the human heart a temple, the soul an altar, the mind a priest. On the cross, you were more dignified than 1,000 kings upon 1,000 thrones in 1,000 empires. To try and find words just to say what Jesus did and what it meant is quite impossible, other than to realize and to believe from the heart that in his death he has overcome our death. And through the resurrection by which he overcame that death, we too will rise in glory. Each of the gospel writers has their own very specific understanding and insight into the passion of Jesus. And for Mark, the gospel we've just had proclaimed, he emphasizes the total and utter isolation of Jesus. From that moment in Gethsemane, when his friends fell asleep, to the betrayal by one whom he himself had chosen, from the desertion of his closest friends, by the denial of those one closer to him, Peter, by the isolation on the cross, there's no mention of any companions, anybody there. The only consolation, and this was forced upon him, was on the way, the soldiers were frightened he would die. So they enlisted Simon of Cyrene to help Jesus to carry the cross. And it could well be that Mark only mentioned that because he mentioned that Simon is the father of Alexander and Rufus, clearly two well-known Christians in the church of which Mark was part. And it's interesting that they are Christians. And it could well have been that the Father Simon, in carrying the cross behind Jesus, experienced that healing of Jesus in his own soul and came to faith in Jesus. Even on the cross, Jesus cried, my God, why have you forsaken me? He's actually quoting Psalm 21, which ends up on a joyous proclamation of faith. But as we hear just those words upon the cross, the isolation of Jesus is emphasized. And it highlights for me just the power of evil and the destructiveness of evil. And when we claim that we are Christians and disciples of Jesus, it must be our dearest wish to confront evil in every possible form. And we see it all the time, all around us. We're seeing it so clearly in Gaza and Ukraine as well, and Haiti. And we're seeing people who are destroyed by the greed and the power and the corruption. And one would say, if things never changed since the time of the Roman Empire, to try to stuff out and snuff out the life of the one whom God had sent to bring salvation to the world. But the challenge of Jesus is a challenge to those who follow him. If we had been successful by God's grace evangelizing the whole of humanity, which was the plan of Jesus and the plan of those early disciples of Jesus, things would have been different. But the power of evil will only be ultimately overcome when Jesus comes in glory something we must pray for, his second coming in glory, and only then will salvation be complete. But you and I, my dear friends, have got a calling. Through the revelation that Jesus has made to each of us in the faith that we have, we are to make this world, those whom we meet, those with whom we share our lives, happier people, more blessed people, forgiven people. That we ourselves, by imitating the example of Jesus in every way, are to be effective in transforming our world. Because that was the plan, and that is the plan. During this week, we have a number of services, and through our sacramental system, by using signs and words, signs which are so meaningful to us, the bread and the wine and the oil and the fire and the light and the words, we ourselves are living through that saving work of Jesus. If Jesus was in isolation throughout his agony, through the celebrations in which we take part, invited to take part, we are indeed sharing with him. We are his companions. And through the symbols and through the words and through the singing and through all that we do, we are taking part in his saving work of salvation. So, my dear friends, make this week a holy week. Make it the most special week you've ever had in your whole lives. Just let the meaning of the death of Jesus really take root in your hearts, so that at Easter, at the Easter vigil on an Easter day, we can truly celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. And there's a resurrection taking place in our own hearts, in our own lives, and the lives of those whose lives we share. Because we believe that Jesus truly has risen, that he has overcome the power of death and evil, and that each of us, by adhering and staying close to him, are giving glory to God and are indeed helping to transform our world. Let us stand and we'll make our act of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
What an experience it must have been for the people witnessing Christ's triumphal entry into Jerusalem, to see his joyful face, to meet his eyes, to experience his love and tenderness to all. We pray, Lord, for those who have no faith, those in despair, those searching for some meaning in life. May we bring your kindness and love into all our relationships, bringing peace and hope to all those we meet each day. Thank you, dearest Lord, for our faith. Keep it bright within us. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
How do we hold on to hope in the midst of such violence and cruel wars, mass shootings, and the catastrophe of unchecked climate change? Dear Lord, we call out to you for help and reassurance, for peace and for justice. And Lord, we recognize too that we must play our part. We live out our faith each day, one decision at a time. Do we forgive or hold a grudge? Do we offer help or look the other way? Are we willing to stop and listen to another's pain, or are we too busy? Dearest Lord, help us to be your eyes and ears, your gentle, healing hands in our world, never ceasing to believe that you are still at the helm and that all will be well. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
I'd like to pray for all those who work in our wonderful NHS. Theirs is such important work with long hours and often little recognition. I recently had a cataract operation that was so efficient and calmly and kindly done. My daughter's father-in-law yesterday had life-saving surgery, and I know that our own dear Maureen and Florence have recently had successful operations. We have so much to be grateful for, and yet it is all under threat from terrible funding cuts. So we pray, Lord, for all those facing long waits for treatment, for all who live in chronic pain, and we pray too for all the researchers trying so hard to find better treatments. We pray that our NHS itself will recover and be strong again. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. We pray for our sick friends. We pray for Maureen Murphy. Pray for Princess Kate, Bobby Connor, Claire, Glyn Blackburn, Maria Evans, Tom O'Shea, Sheila Kane, Lil Borton, Wilf Godwin, Peter Nash, Deirdre Kelly, Marion Scully. Who else would you like to include who is ill at this time? Lord, the friends whom you love are ill. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. We pray for those who have died. Today, remember especially Michael Armstrong. We pray for Kenneth Griffin, whose funeral is on Tuesday. Pray for Father Austin, whose anniversary it is. Who else would you like to pray for who has died? Lord, in your mercy, we pray Mary to Mary, the Mother of Sorrows. Together we pray. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Dearest God, our lives, our hopes, everything, Lord, is in your hands. Just let us respond to your grace through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
away my iniquity and cleanse me of my sin. So pray, my sisters and brothers, pray that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that, though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Holy, 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 my heart, my heart. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly give you praise, for through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Anne and St. Bernard, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope, and Malcolm our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. Amen. With one voice, let us give praise to God in the words that Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us greet each other with a sign of the peace of Christ. Lamb of God, this is the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Happy and blessed are those who are called to the Lord's table. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Body of Christ, bring us to everlasting life. An act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the most holy sacrament of the altar. I love you with all my heart, and I passionately desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come spiritually into my soul, that I may be united with you now and forever. Amen. And may the blood of Christ bring us to everlasting life.
nourished with these sacred gifts. We humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as with the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection, you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Like to sit down, please. I'm afraid the battery went on this personal mics just at the end of the Eucharistic prayer, I think, around that time. And so hopefully it was picked up by one of the other mics, I think. This week, every service this week will be live streamed. And what we have on Tuesday night is our service of reconciliation with the General Absolution. That will be at 7:30 on Tuesday. On Wednesday morning after the Mass, we're actually going to show a film. It's actually Mark's Gospel. And it's a very beautiful presentation. It's part of what they call the LUMA project. And I see on YouTube it's had 10 million hits. 4 million hits. And it's the reading of the gospel with actors behind. So we are going to show this actually on straight after Mass in the St. Anne's Room on Wednesday morning. Because this week, of course, the Wednesday Mass will be in the morning, because in the evening, it's the Mass of Chrism at the Cathedral. On Thursday evening, we have the Mass of the Lord's Supper, after which the altar is stripped, and we can pray before the altar repose, and as long as you wish, really. And then on Good Friday, of course, we have at 3 o'clock the service, the commemoration of the Lord's, of the death of the Lord, the crucifixion of Jesus. And then, of course, the great Easter Vigil on Saturday evening, which is at 7:30. That evening, incidentally, the hour's going forward. So this time next week, when you're coming for Sunday Mass, Easter Sunday Mass, it's an hour earlier. So that's the night that we lose the hour's sleep. But anyhow, for the Easter Vigil Mass, it's very, very beautiful. Those who have never been to it has taken part in it. It's the most important celebration of the whole year, as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, using the symbols of fire, light, water. And we're baptizing two new Christians, Nick and Ellie, and indeed Ellie's little daughter, Sophia, and confirming Ellie and Nick, and also Jeannie and Ernie. Anything else, anybody? Just a special week. Oh, Friday is, of course, Good Friday, a day of fasting and abstinence. Chris Cram?
A special request has been made for the children to meet at the children's chapel. Thanks.
And Chris Cram. Are we any birthdays today? I know we have one. We have an honourable gentleman who is 50 today, but he tells me he's not going to come forward. But we wish him a very happy birthday. But we do have some birthdays. I see some fingers being pointed. Whether or not that means going to come forward is another matter. No. Okay. Come on, my love. No personal questions asked. It's your son's birthday.
Yeah, he's 53.
He is 53 today. This is his son. What's your name?
Nikki.
Yes, Nikki. Nikki's son, actually, she's not for herself, but her son, very dear to her, 53 today. Hey? And what's his name?
Craig.
Craig. So can we wish Craig a happy birthday? And? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Craig and Aaron. Happy birthday to you. Hip hip.
Craig.
Hip hip.
Craig.
Nikki Pip. Okay, Nikki. God bless you. We pray for the renewal of our parish. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Melt us, mold us, fill us, use us. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Just reminded that there's tea and coffee in the St. Anne's room today, and also Joe and Mike, because this Mass is for their son, Michael, they brought a box of biscuits, I think, and some juice for the children. So the Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God keep you safe. God bless your day. Let us go with Christ in our hearts.
I'm